Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2023. Alex Riley has given his apologies for this meeting and I welcome Jackie Bailey, who is attending as his substitute. Agenda item 1 is decision taken to take item 5, consideration of a draft legacy paper in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes. Yes.
Are agreed. Thank you. We're agreed to take agenda number 5 and item. Agenda item number 2, recovery of NHS dental services. This morning we will conclude our evidence taking on the inquiry into recovery of NHS dental services, and I'd like to welcome to the meeting Jenny Minto, Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, Tom Ferris, the Chief Dental Officer and Deputy Director for Dentistry, Optometry and Audiology Division, and David Notman, the Unit Head for Dentistry, Optometry and Audiology Division at the Scottish Government. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. Minister, would you like to make any short opening remarks before we move to questions?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I would. And thank you for inviting me to support the important work of the committee and provide an update about the Scottish Government's commitment to NHS dental services through the pandemic and sustaining provision and patient access to these services in the long term. I shall be happy to answer any questions that the committee has in connection with Scottish Government's written response on the 25th of May. And I'm supported in this session, as you've noted, by Chief Dental Officer Tom Ferris and Senior Policy Official David Notman, who have been in post throughout the pandemic period and will be able to provide further information and policy context that may be of use to members. If I may, I would like to reflect briefly on the significant journey that NHS dental services have been on since the outset of the pandemic and the subsequent recovery of NHS dental services. The committee will be very much aware that NHS dental services were disproportionately impacted at the earliest point, with full cessation of services on the 23rd of March 2020 being the immediate and necessary response to the emerging pandemic emergency, and that the necessary cautious remobilisation of services was similarly impacted due to the potential of coronavirus to be spread by aerosol-generating procedures in the dental setting. During this challenging period, the Scottish Government put in place £150 million of emergency financial support and PPE when public health concerns and infection prevention control measures prevented the sector from operating normally. We see preservation of the sector the first stage in ensuring we can adequately recover NHS dental services. The Scottish Government implemented a significant policy intervention in February 2022 that removed the basic examination fee and replaced it with an increased fee for an enhanced examination, including for under 18s. This policy change means that all patient examinations, including children, provide the dental contractor with a higher fee for a longer examination appointment, resulting in a reduced need to deliver a high volume of care. This change was reflective of the sectoral representation to the Scottish Government during the pandemic and also of engagement in the development of the Oral Health Improvement Plan, OHIP, that clinicians were unable to provide the modern dental care they felt their patients required under the high volume arrangements, as the payment model was not reflective of new techniques or clinical discretion. The effect of providing the enhanced examination is that clinicians are now able to spend more time with their patients and are able to provide patients with improved preventative care. The intention of that reform builds on OHIP to further support patients receiving the right care at the right time. The recovery of NHS dental services from the pandemic period is shown in official figures published by Public Health Scotland. NHS dentistry delivered over 3.8 million patient contacts in 2022-23. This compares to 2.8 million the previous year and 1.5 million at the height of the pandemic in 2020-21. While we're not where we would like to be, we have achieved a great deal. I also want to provide in my opening statement something of a context of recovery. While Scottish Government support has taken the sector some of the way towards full recovery, there are external economic, workforce and capacity factors in dental labs that will require a longer time frame to fully address. It's also worth reflecting briefly on the underlying conditions at play in the sector, as the cost of materials and staff are impacting significantly on the ability of practices to remain viable. While the Scottish Government can and has made specific interventions, the committee should note that it's not within the gift of government to fully insulate NHS dentistry from these challenges. So our keystone is payment reform, which I know the committee will want to go into more detail about. And we see this as a significant step forward. And the Scottish Government is presently engaged in sensitive negotiations with BDA Scotland around setting fees under the reformed model that deliver the OHIP, with a strong focus on preventative care. I would hope to be in a position to provide further details to the sector and the committee, if that is helpful, upon conclusion of that negotiation. And running alongside the implementation of payment reform are a range of mitigations with a main focus on island and rural areas. The committee will be aware of specific interventions through the Scottish Dental Access Initiative and recruitment and retention incentives targeted for certain board areas. But we're also working closely with affected boards on different models of care so we have greater resilience in the future. In summary, while we have made progress, Scottish Government has still got significant work to do to support the sector and is focusing on delivering reforms that ensure sustained and equitable services for the long term. With the help of committee members, I'd like to explore the challenges and possible solutions as we move forward.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that extensive response. We're going to turn to questions now, and we'll hand over to Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning, colleagues. We've been taking evidence for the last 2 weeks from various stakeholders. We've heard from NHS boards, we've heard from representatives of patient interests, and we've heard from dentists in the profession. Now, in your letter to us, Minister, of the 25th of May, a letter to the Convener, you say the policy of the Scottish Government throughout the pandemic has been to preserve and protect NHS dentistry. In my view, we have successfully done this. I'm bound to say I don't think the evidence we've heard reflects that statement. For example, what we heard last week from the dentists was there's been a loss of 52% capacity in NHS dentistry since COVID. In fact, many of the issues with NHS dentistry existed pre-COVID, but were accelerated and exacerbated by the problem. There are many areas in Scotland now where there are no NHS dentists at all. Kinross, in the Convener's constituency, he'll be familiar with, is an area where you cannot now get an NHS dentist. Newburgh and Fife, in my region as well, is another area. There are lots of other examples. And even where people are registered with NHS dentists, they are waiting extreme periods of time to get appointments for routine work. We've also heard, for example, that although we have new entrants coming into the profession, graduates coming out don't want to do NHS work. They want to go into private practice because they have more time to spend with patients. So the picture we've had painted for us is a very unhappy one. Would you like to revise your comment in your letter that everything's fine?
I thank you for that very long question. I think the actions that the Scottish Government took going into the pandemic to support the dental area, dental services, were absolutely needed. And I think if that work hadn't been done, if that investment hadn't been made, then I can't imagine where we would be sitting now. We still have a lot of dental practices. Perhaps, yes, I would accept that there are some concerns. However, what we are trying to do and discussing with the dental groups are the need to stabilise the profession, and that's exactly what our discussions have been around. I can remember seeing the queues, and I think this was referenced by some of the evidence that you received, the queues around dental practices maybe 20 or so years ago. I don't believe we are at that point. Reflecting on where we've got to, the support that has been given to dental practices throughout the pandemic, and building on the evidence that we have received from dentists when we did the survey, the OHIP work, there is a recognition that we need to continue to work with the profession to ensure that we do get the right levels of treatment and the right access for people. And I think that's what recovery looks like, is when we can see that we've got the right number of dental practices providing the right services so that people can get access to that and we stabilise the profession. And I believe that's what my colleagues have been working incredibly hard with the dental sector to ensure that we have. And I think as well the introduction and the connection that we have within the NHS health boards and the support that we have provided them in various areas across Scotland specifically to try and maintain access to dental services is incredibly important.
But it's not happening though, is it? Because all the evidence we hear, both in this committee and as representatives locally, is that access to NHS dentistry is still reducing. There are still practices who were doing NHS dentistry that are now stopped, and there are people coming to us all the time saying they want to get an NHS dentist and they can't find anyone who will take them on their books.
So I think you also received evidence from NHS Borders that was very clear in the work that they are doing directly with practices and the support that the Scottish Government has been able to give through the SDAI grants to £100,000 for a new practice and £25,000 for further practices. There is work going on, and I think we have to be careful that we don't paint such a dark picture across the whole areas. And I think that there are areas, and I think the dental directors within each of the health boards have got a very good relationship with their dental practices. And that relationship and with my officials ensures that we understand where problems are. For example, in Tayside, there's been specific requests in specific areas where they recognise that they need to attract more people. And so as a result, that work is being done and they're now included in the ability to get SDAIs. So where I accept that we have got a distance to go in a lot of areas, I think we are making progress.
OK, well, we'll see if progress is being made in due course. If you look at the pattern of change, you're absolutely right. I remember 20 years ago, there was a big issue with lack of NHS dentists. There were queues outside practices. There was a big ramp up then in training and recruitment of dentists. A lot more dentists came into the profession. That was a great success. But what's been happening over the last maybe 5 years or more is there has been progress with NHS dentists increasingly moving to do more private work. And what's happened during COVID is suddenly that has accelerated. And people are now having increasingly to turn to private dentistry because they cannot get an NHS dentist. Now, people are in a fortunate position, perhaps they can afford to do that. There are many people who can't afford that. Therefore, they're falling through the gap. So we have a real issue of inequality. I suppose my question would be, what is the Scottish Government's vision for dentistry? Because we've always had a mixed economy. We've always had dentists doing private work and NHS work. The growth has been in private work, NHS work has shrunk. How does the government see the profession going forward? And if we're going to retain NHS dentistry, given we know that a lot of young people coming into the profession are more attracted to doing private work, is that only going to be achievable with a substantial injection of additional cash? And if so, where's that coming from?
So I think we need to remember that about 45% of the population of Scotland can access dentistry free on the NHS, and I think that's very important to remember. As you know, the Scottish...
Sorry, if they can find a dentist.
There is also the ability to get dental care through phoning up your NHS boards, and I know the NHS boards, along with the directors of dentistry in each of the NHS boards, are looking to improve that facility as well. I mean, it was a SNP manifesto commitment for free NHS dentistry, and in the policy prospectus, what we have said is that we want to stabilise the profession and make it sustainable, and that's where we're going. It is still a commitment given. We are in really quite difficult financial circumstances, but I would hope that we can move towards a free NHS dental service, hopefully within the length of this parliamentary session. And I think it's important to recognise the fact that we've been taking steps to achieve that by allowing free dentistry for people up to the age of 25 or under 26.
Yeah, and so And some of the evidence we heard from the dental practice owners was that under 25s are coming forward wanting cosmetic treatments such as teeth whitening, which is putting a burden on them. And I really wonder whether that is the best use of limited resource. You mentioned the commitment for extension of free services for everyone. I mean, how credible is that that will be delivered? Clearly, you know, the whole system is creaking at the seams at the moment. There isn't enough money to fund what we're offering at the moment. Is it realistic to think that within 3 years we can give free NHS dental care to everyone and that will be actually accessible? There will be the dentist to deliver it.
So with regards to the teeth whitening, as I understand it, that is not a normal piece of treatment for people under 25 to be able to get on the NHS. It would only be in specific circumstances. So I was slightly surprised when I heard that piece of evidence as well. So I wanted to understand what was behind that. As I've referenced, we're in really difficult financial constraints just now. But I think our vision has to be that we have the best oral health that we can have. And I think, from my perspective, if we can ensure that we can provide that to the people of Scotland, then I think that's a really important preventative way to avoid additional spending later on. So my job is to try and work out the way to find that, to ensure that happens. And I have my officials working with me and working with the dental sector to look at different ways that we can perhaps achieve that.
OK, I think I'm probably out of time, Camilla. Yes, thank you.
I'll move on to Jackie Bailey and Prevented Dentists in Child's Mill.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Minister. I think Child Smile, I think we would all describe as a flagship programme introduced by the last Labour Scottish Government and continued helpfully by the SNP. But what we're seeing is a growing inequality gap between the least and the most deprived areas, particularly when it comes to children's oral health. Now, before COVID, I think there was a problem, but that problem has been exacerbated by COVID. What we're now seeing is registrations of very young children have dropped dramatically. Only, I think, 25% of 0 to 2-year-olds are registered, which is desperately worrying because that has an impact on later life. Child Smile, we don't think, has returned to pre-pandemic levels. And so in relation to children's oral health, what are you doing to address those concerns? But equally, we know that extends into adults as well. So what specific measures are you taking to address inequalities in adults' access to dentistry?
Yeah, I was concerned as well when I saw the level of young children that aren't registered at dentists. And I would like to commend everybody that has worked on Child Smile because it clearly has made vast improvements. And I was pleased to see that the Scottish Government invested a further 1.9 million over 2 years. And I think that allows about over 400,000 packs to get into child settings, whether it's nurseries or dental practices as well, to ensure that children are getting that important lesson, education, I suppose. And then also, let's not forget the baby box as well, which also supports in oral health as well. And I think your question was specifically around what specific targets have we met? Well, I've talked earlier about the improved fee to dentists, which allows them to see children, and that's incredibly important. I think there was over 600,000 child examinations carried out, which I think is a really good start. I know when you were taking evidence from Public Health Scotland, there was some indication that perhaps going out into nursery schools hadn't ramped up to the same pre-COVID level. So that's clearly something that we need to ensure happens. And I don't think we can also forget the Community Oral Health Challenge Fund, which has specifically focused and targeted on communities of greater need. So in Ayrshire, for example, the child services there have done specific work with children with additional needs to get them using their being aware of their child their hygiene, oral hygiene as well. And I think it's these relationships directly into communities that is going to make the difference. So in so many areas of the role that I carry out, it is that relationship between government and the professions and the third sector organisations. And I think the third sector organisations have played a very important role. And I know you took some evidence with regard to inequalities and ethnic minorities. And again, that's something that I know that the health boards and their directors of dentists have been working very carefully and closely with. And I think it's that relationship, that tripartite relationship, that will improve how we get on. So it's in the investment, but it's also the ensuring of the advertising to ensure that that happens. And I think that is where we're making improvements.
Okay, given you've described the kind of interventions you're making, particularly for children, do you think that, you know, that's enough to restore registration levels? And if you do, have you set a target for what percentage of registrations you expect and by what time? Because obviously, you know, targets drive improving performance. And have you equally set targets for closing that inequality gap, which is in fact growing?
So, as I understand it, I think registration has actually increased, certainly amongst adults, and I would hope that the work that we are doing with regards to ensuring that oral health care and brushing, etc., is happening in settings where children are, that would have a knock-on effect. I'm not aware of any targets being set, but maybe Tom can...
Sure. We do have the National Dental Inspection Programme, which is a programme that goes out every year to measure the oral health of children in Primary 1 and Primary 7. And we do have targets of 75% of Primary 1 children by 2024 would have no sign of obvious decay, and 80% of Primary 7s by 2024. The most recent measure we have is 2022 for Primary 1s, and it's 73%. Now, you know, that the pandemic may have an impact on that, and it may dip a bit, but we do have a target. And in terms of the inequality measure, we were working on something called the slope index of inequality, where we look at the difference between the most affluent quintile and the most deprived quintile, and we would want to see that reducing across boards. And that was just from very early work, and that will commence now with the next school term as we ramp child smell back up to where it was, because, as you say, it's almost back to where it was, but there are still some schools and nurseries where it's not quite happening. So we need to build the relationships again with those individual head teachers. And if we have issues, I've got education policy colleagues in Scottish Government. We also have worked previously with the directors of education in COSLA, who are really helpful in driving the attention towards schools working with us to improve oral health.
I suppose what I'm trying to do is get a sense of the urgency of this, because if we're still sitting at 0 to 2s at only 25% registration, that is going to have a knock-on effect. And we know if you don't prevent, it costs you more money to treat, you know, disease later on. So I'm keen to get a sense of, when do you expect those targets to be achieved? Is there any kind of additional remediation that you're doing because of COVID and to try and recover from that?
So Child Smile has an arm where they work with new parents just after the child is born. It's usually a referral by health visitor, and those families are facilitated to register with a dentist. So that should be happening again. Equally, any young child who attends NHS 24 because they're in pain will be followed up by the local health board to make sure that the family get into care, either by registration with a general dental practitioner or by going to the public dental service for care. And any child who, through the school inspection process, is identified as being at high risk, they will be followed up by the health board or health improvement teams too, again, to make sure that the family has the support, they get into Child Smile, but equally they get registered with a practice or with the public dental service. So there are various touch points where we do contact families and engage with families to get registration. I accept 0 to 2 registrations are low. They are always the lowest cohort of the population, but it's not great where it is. Yeah. And we need to put a lot of effort into that as we go forward.
Yeah, I think it's even lower just now than it's ever been.
Yes, I agree.
So,
yes.
Okay. Can I talk more widely about prevention? Because certainly the dentist we had before us talked, you know, about prevention virtually with every breath that they took, which I very much welcomed. Yet what they described was a funding model, let me get this right, that was high volume, low fee, disease centred. And they felt that they weren't able to do the kind of prevention work they wanted. Let me give you one example. One dentist raised with us the ability to bring a group of children together to do education work on prevention, but the fee model doesn't allow them to do that. So I'm keen to know what improvements you'll make that would enhance the ability of dentists to actually do prevention, and what you as a government will do beyond the touch points you've described at population level to improve access to dentistry, so that we can ensure that there is more preventative work taken.
So I watched that evidence, and I think that's one of the key things that we have to talk about is the flexibility of staffing within dental practices and what then that would allow them to do perhaps on a different scale. But I think if I go back to what I said earlier, the thing that we have to move forward on positively is getting the right fee structure, and as I said, we're in negotiations with the BDA about that. I suppose there is Child Smile is given in dental practices as well, and I think that's important because it's kind of introducing children to a dental practice, so you hopefully would then avoid the anxiety that some children have when it comes to visiting the dentist. So I mean, I'm happy for our discussions with the BDA and other dentists to kind of move into that area, looking at the flexibility of staff, because I think that's incredibly important. But I think that is a more longer term look at how we structure support for dentists. I was very aware that prevention is absolutely one of the key things, and I referenced that earlier in my introductory notes, that if we don't get the prevention right, then that ends up costing us in the longer term. I think I'll stop there.
So just so that I don't want to put words in your mouth, but what I seem to hear from you is that the ability to be more flexible around about prevention is not in the current discussion about fees.
So the current discussion about fees is looking at the type of the volume of the fees and how we can make that more patient helpful, but also looking at how it's easier and less bureaucratic for the dentists.
Okay,
David, do you want to say something?
Yeah, just say a little bit more about without alluding too much to the negotiations that are currently going on, is the payments model is a radical revision of what we currently do in dentistry. It's got a great deal more focus on prevention than we currently have. So we are going to be looking specifically at a more preventative focus within the fee per item model, I should say, a more preventative focus than we presently have. So my sense is that, yes, there are discussions that are currently going on, obviously, but we are also being cognizant of the need to be more prevention focused, and that is being reflected in the model that we're developing.
Okay. The dentist, and I will stop here, convener, the dentist did describe that model as preventing them from doing the kind of dental work that I've described. So we just need to wait and see what you come up with. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. John.
Myself next. I think probably following on from that, it said in your letter before we started the inquiry, the Scottish Government takes the view that the present blended system of payment comprising fee per item, capitation allowance and direct reimbursement payment should remain. So, I mean, certainly what we've heard, and I mean, I know that Mr. Notman used the word radical just now, but we it has been suggested, I think, by the dentists more that this is just tweaking the system and they really would like something more radical. And one suggestion is to move on to a system more like the GPs. Now, I speak to GPs, they're not entirely happy with their system, but they seem to be a bit happier than dentists are. Would that be an option?
I think what the government has said is that we want to continue the blended model, which does have an element of capitation. So the dentists get paid per patient that is registered. I acknowledge that if the dentist hasn't seen that patient for, I think it's 3 years, then that fee per patient does reduce. But I think that's a strong model, and then it's a fee per item of work that's done, and that's what we're looking at changing, simplifying, making it less bureaucratic for the dentists, and I think that's the right way to go. I note your point about GPs as well, but I think with regards to dental care across Scotland, we have to look at the models that are across Scotland, and the blended model we believe works best for the practices across the length and breadth of Scotland and our islands. David, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, for me, I accept the point that's being made. Our view presently is that if you look at the empirical evidence, a purely capitation style model invariably leads to an under-treatment problem. We have got empirical evidence across the UK from the early 1990s when that was done in dentistry, but we've also got empirical evidence from the COVID period. We did the right thing in March 2020. We suspended the fee per item model, and we allowed an emergency support system to support dentists, which is effectively very similar to capitation. And the difficulty we find is that if you pay individuals, economic agents and their independent contractors, regardless of what they do, we go to the bottom in terms of actual patient care and treatments. The fee per item model, the disadvantage of the fee per item model is that if we accelerate that too much, you tend to get an over-treatment of patients. So the reason why the government narrative is a blended system of fee per item and capitation and allowances is because that way we get the strengths of each individual component of payment without unmitigating the weaknesses. So it would not be our position to move across to what is described as the GMS model, the General Medical Services model, on the basis that a pure capitation model in dentistry, we view, would lead to a reduction in NHS treatment and a very significant and perpetual increase in oral health inequality. It has to be, the payment model has to be a blended system of payments to ensure that we can maintain treatments to NHS patients, and we can only do that through fee per item, a retention of the fee per item model within that wider construct of different payments, including capitation. So that is essentially, in a nutshell, our argument. The other thing I would venture to the committee is that we need to be incredibly careful. We have over 1,000 dental practices in Scotland, all of whom have different business models, many of whom are actually wedded to the present payment system that the Scottish Government offers. Radical change in terms of moving away from fee per item and replacing with capitation would be financially very destabilising. There are around 400 to 500 practices in Scotland that have over 90% NHS care, and that would be potentially very destabilising to the sector and lead to a set of outcomes that we do not even want to consider, and it would have been within our discretion. So that's essentially, in a very quick summary, of the government's position with respect to capitation.
Okay, well, I mean, at the risk of going over this ground again, I mean, the Minister, you said that we've got a strong model, and you say that it would get a lot worse if we moved to a different system. But the reality is, my dentist has not been in touch with me since before COVID until I wrote to them and asked them. They've stopped doing reminders. So, I mean, my dental care cannot get any lower, and that's in Glasgow, in a city. And we had people along here from Shetland who said their system is not working. I think they've got one practice, and they've got a director of dentistry. I mean, how do you need a director of dentistry for one practice? I don't understand that. So, we've been hearing evidence that, you know, this present system is not working. You suggest that it would be worse if we moved to the capitation model because practices would move away from the NHS perhaps, or it would be destabilised. But from what we're picking up, there is a strong drift away from the NHS. Not necessarily in the numbers, but a practice like the one I go to, which has stopped sending out reminders. Others have deregistered. The one I go to hasn't. So we just seem to be getting that across the board. And when we hear people speaking to a GP or medical students, they're not wondering whether they be in the NHS or not. They're wondering whether they go into hospital or GP practice, and that's an issue. But when people are speaking to the dental students, they're saying, we don't even want to go into the NHS. So, I mean, do you not accept there's something fundamentally wrong here?
So I accept that we have challenges, absolutely. I think what I would say is that the national picture presently, when we talked a little bit about registration, we've retained a very high registration of NHS patients. And I would argue that that's the base position with regard to access. We're also seeing something of a recovery. You know, we did put in place short-term recovery measures through Public Health Scotland, and we've seen across the key treatment groups a very significant increase in these key treatments. The Minister's already referenced the fact that we're up at around 4 million patient contacts against around 5 to 5.5 million before the pandemic. So that gives you the context of where dentistry is. In terms of participation, which is the numbers of patients that see a patient in a two-year period, we're now on track to a very similar position before the pandemic. So the point I would make to you is, and I do say this with the greatest of respect to the committee, is that I think the national picture, I wouldn't describe the national picture in the darkest possible terms. I think the national picture is reasonable. It's not without challenge, but we do have some very serious local challenges, and I do accept that within certain parts of Scotland, we're seeing a more significant challenge to accessing dental services than across the nation as a whole. It's the job of the Scottish Government to put in place that national framework to support boards and that local provision, and that's what I think we are trying to do. So I do accept that there are different narratives playing out here, but I just wanted to bring us back to the fact that the national stats show that we have done a great deal in terms of bringing dentistry back to a position that is not incomparable with what it was before the pandemic. But within a local sphere, I accept that some patients will be struggling with access, and there are some local problems that we need to address.
OK, well, if I could just ask one other question on a slightly different tack. Do we actually know what the state of the nation's oral health is? Because you've told us at primary level, is it primary one, primary seven, you're actually checking the kids' teeth, you know that a percentage have no decay or have decay. Do we know that for adults?
Tom?
Tom,
we don't have an adult equivalent of the child inspection programme at all. However, that is one of the things we're trying to build in to the reform system, that there are key, and the greatest indicator of someone's risk of future disease is past disease. So actually we're trying to build in some key indicators to the reform system that we can extract that data on an anonymised basis and use that actually to inform the clinician of the oral health of their case list. We can aggregate that up to practice level and to board level and to national level. So we're trying to get that information with the least bureaucracy as possible and as easy to as part of people's day-to-day work. So we're trying to build in the key indicators that will come from the enhanced examination that they're currently doing, and we just extract that data, Public Health Scotland, use that data and then build out the stats from that. So that's a weakness, absolutely. We don't have that information. We have the Scottish Health Survey, which is self-reported stats about the number of teeth and dentures and attendance. And so it's fine as far as it goes, but we need something better because we need metrics to prove. But actually, we need outcomes. At the moment, we count virtually every widget that we do. But actually, what's the point of a lot of that stuff? We really need to understand what's the outcome of doing those widgets. And I think so it's an outcome metric that we're looking for. And we're working on that as part of the new reform.
Well, I think that's very positive, so that's a good note for me to finish on. Right, thank you.
OK, thank you very much, John. David, if you don't mind, I'm going to come to you very quickly on something you've just said. You're saying that across the country, generally, that you've got a lot of dentists who are wedded to the system that's there. But we've heard that members of the SDA and the SDPO say they have been completely excluded from talks and negotiations about reform. Are you not hearing that people want reform?
So I think they're two different things in a way, and that the point I was making was that I think fee per item is a very strong incentive mechanism for dentists to provide NHS care. If we look at the stats, we find that there's a large proportion of practices that have a high volume model. And it gives dentists the discretion of income as well. So they can decide how much dentistry they want or don't want to do. So from my perspective, I think there is a large proportion of practices in the Scottish population that want to provide NHS dentistry, and the fee per item model provides the incentive for them to do so. Slightly separate question with respect to SDA and SDPO. We have very regular discussions with BDA Scotland. BDA Scotland is the representative body for the profession in Scotland. We also have intelligence through the boards with the directors of dentistry, and we have quite a lot of networks within dentistry to give us that level of intelligence. With the Oral Health Improvement Plan in 2018, we had about 20 to 25 roadshows in Scotland, and we had a huge consultation exercise with all dentists and over 500 responses. And most of the Oral Health Improvement Plan is feeding into this discussion around reform and how we take forward the recovery of NHS dental services. So we do have a very substantial network across Scotland in terms of understanding the difficulties that dentists have. So that would be my sense of things in terms of where we are with discussions with the profession.
Okay. Am I right in thinking the BDA doesn't represent all high street dentists?
I think government has to take a view, and our view is that the BDA is the representative body. They have, for us, they can provide us with what I would describe as a delegated mandate. They've got a clear delegated mandate from dentists who are members of the BDA, based on a membership fee, to discuss with Scottish Government. So ministers have to set the line as to who they would regard as a representative body. So it may very well be that the BDA do not have the full all GDPs, but they're able to provide evidence to us that they have a delegated authority from GDPs that are members.
Yes, please.
So the Scottish Dental Practice Committee of BDA represents all primary care dentists because they come from the local dental committees of health boards, and the membership of the LDC at health board level isn't dependent on being a BDA member. So there will be LDC members at health boards who are not members of the BDA, but they are local GDPs. There are subsequent elections forward onto the SDPC, and they form that representative body for us. They cover the length and breadth of all the boards and different areas of Scotland. So we get a full gamut of the GDPs in that committee who come to us and bring their side of the story. And I think that's important. There's a kind of democratic mandate behind BDA that allows us to know that we're dealing with an organisation that is truly representative. And I think we need to hear that from other organisations who would like to inhabit a similar space.
OK, it seems a very cluttered... If anyone was sitting listening to that just now who didn't know anything about dentistry, they wouldn't have a clue what you were talking about because there's so many acronyms in there. Yeah.
Same for medicine and GP.
The only point that I'm trying to push here is that we've had people in front of us saying that they are completely unheard and excluded from the conversation. And I'm just wondering if that's something that might be considered after we've concluded our evidence and come back to you, that there are clearly people who are in the private dental practice who don't think, despite the fact that we've got NHS roles to play, that they are simply not being heard. And I think that's something we should consider. Brian, I'll move on to you just now. Thanks.
Thank you, Kavina. Good morning, Minister. I've been listening with interest to what's been said today, and I think, I'm reflecting on the dentistry view that seems to be being portrayed here, and I have to say it's markedly different than the evidence we've heard beforehand. And as a committee, we have to obviously assess the evidence that comes before us. As my colleague Jackie Bailey said, I mean, dentists repeatedly talked about wanting to look at prevention. And you will know, Minister, that's a passion of mine. But they also said that there was no immediate strategy or capacity to clear any backlog on immediate poor oral health. In fact, last week we heard that under the current system, they thought the backlog would never be clear. So for me, it's the concern here is the huge gulf between what the evidence we're hearing here today and the evidence we've heard over the last couple of weeks. Now, there's a couple of things I wanted to mention. One, the fact that because of the big gaps between being seen between appointments, what they're having to do is the dentistry they're having to apply is much more complex, which is obviously an indication of a problem, and also the fact that they get paid when the treatment is finished. And if it's taking longer to do that treatment, so if there's an appointment and then there's a filling in 3 months and there's a filling in another 3 months, they're not getting paid for a further 6 months. And they're saying that system can't continue. So I think if we're going to fix this, which I think we all want to do, we have to understand what reality is. How do we as a committee help us here? How do we go from the gulf of what the evidence we've heard, the painting of a dentistry system here, where, as John Mason said, we have students saying that they don't want to work in NHS, and we also know that the current NHS dentistry is they're drifting towards private. How do we go from that? How do we close that gulf from what you're saying and the evidence of what we are hearing?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Whittle, for that question. I think there's a few elements to that. I think we've been quite clear that we do recognise we have a distance to go to make the dental service the one that we actually want it to be. With regards to the backlog, I think you got evidence, and certainly I've experienced this from my own dental practice, in the 6 monthly is what I think what we all grew up expecting. That was the normal time to return to the dentist. Actually, the dentist can make that decision, and it may be actually you don't need to be seen for 9 months or 18 months. Some people may need to be seen more regularly. So I think the dentist has that capacity within their clinical decision making, and that may help reduce some of the waiting times. I think we've also got to remember that throughout the pandemic, we lost a whole cohort of dentists in training, so they weren't able to do their practical experience. And I think we've acknowledged that we're back up to that level of 160 coming through, but it will take a few years to get back from that. And then I think the other thing, the work that we have done is looking at people where we can get other dentists from, and there's a bit of a roadblock there. So certainly in my area, you would get a lot of dentists coming from the EU, but since Brexit, that has reduced. So what I have done is written to my fellow ministers for health in the four nations of the United Kingdom to say, can we find a way of speeding up the entrance of dentists in, and that will help with the capacity. And I think the other thing that I've touched upon as well is looking at what other mitigations can happen. So the use working with the health boards, is there solutions there? And also I touched on as well the flexibility of staff, looking at what different members of the dental teams within practices are actually doing. So I don't think we can fix it next week, but we have been putting in a number of mitigations to do that, including the additional funding, which the Director of Dentistry from NHS Borders talked about at your last evidence session, or the first evidence session that you did.
Minister, doesn't matter how many dentists are in training, if they do not want to go into the NHS dentistry, it will make no difference whatsoever. And over and above that, what we've heard as well is a lot of dentist staff are moving to private practice purely for financial reasons, because in private practice they can pay more. We have to understand what the problem is before we can fix it. And what my concern here is that what we're hearing from one side of the argument and from what we're hearing from you differs so much that I'm not sure that we're I don't know what my colleagues think, but I'm not sure now what the reality is, because we've heard that NHS is under huge pressure across the board, and dentistry seems to be at the worst end of that, and to a point one of them said it's in danger of falling over. We have to accept where reality is. So this idea of we need more dentists, we need more NHS dentists. How do we get more NHS dentists to practice?
So I appreciate that you got evidence that said that young dentists don't wish to go into the NHS. I mean, we've had conversations and we hear the other side of that. So there is still a cohort of dentists that will wish to get their training in an NHS practice. So I think we've got to be very careful about just painting that one side of the picture. There are people that wish to go into NHS, and I think what we've been trying to do with regard to the payment reform is trying to improve the attractiveness, if I may use that word, for new dentists to come in. I mean, in my own constituency, in Dunoon, in the hospital in Dunoon, there's two dental surgeries there, and they are working with fourth year students from Glasgow coming in and getting support from a retired dentist. So it's looking at these things, trying to be, as I've said before, flexible to ensure that we can bring them in. But we do believe that the negotiations that we're having with the BDA are moving to that flexible model to support NHS dentistry.
Just one final question then on that. We heard that there is some treatment. Not only is there a delay, it can be a long delay in getting payment for treatments done. We also heard that there's some treatments on the NHS that actually cost the dentist money to deliver. Is that something that you're looking at the moment?
Yes, it is, and we heard that as well. And I think we are in a cost of living crisis with inflation, high inflation, and the labs that are doing dental work, their fees have gone up. So yes, and we have recognised that and worked with the BDA with regard to that. And I think as well, the other thing we've got to remember as well is things don't stand still. I was at a meeting yesterday talking about life sciences and the amazing work that's happening, coming up with new technology to support. Now, that will help in the preventative field as well, but that's expensive. But in the long term, we would hope that will reduce the requirement for additional care. So, I mean, I'm sure we can all remember having to get putty and things in our mouths to work out what work was needed to be done, whereas now that can be done with a digital scanner, which it will improve throughput. But it's working out how we can do that, and that's also part of our conversations with the wider dentistry sector.
Thank you,
Brian. I'll move on to Stuart now.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, just regarding the issue of the number of dental students, and you mentioned it was 160. Do the Scottish Government have any plans to actually increase that number?
I'm afraid I can't answer that question. Yeah. I'll hand that over to Tom.
Thank you. Yes, we will be considering the number of the intake for the dental schools, but I think we need to be mindful that is it really dentists that we need? David McCall, who sat in this chair, was quite eloquent about skill mix, and I think skill mix is something we need to take seriously, and we haven't really embraced in dentistry. The kind of probably the regulations around it are a bit cumbersome, and we need to fix those. So maybe we need more hygienists and therapists as well as more dentists. So we need to get the number right, because I don't think it is that we just need dentists. I think we need more of all of the team, because I think dentistry nowadays is becoming a team sport, and I think we need to be clear that we facilitate that in government. So, you know, at the moment there's quite advanced plans for a hygienist qualification to be delivered in an FE college in Lanarkshire, and that's the first time that we'll have had a hygiene qualification in Scotland for a couple of decades probably, and that's really important. I've spoken to the therapy schools about could they increase input. And one of the models is based in UHI, and they do a kind of hub and spoke kind of arrangement. So they have small pockets of students, as the Minister alluded to. And are there other areas of Scotland where there's a reduced dental workforce? And actually, is that the best place for some of these kind of schools to be? So I think that conversation is definitely being had. And there's also, at GDC level and General Dental Council level, there are 5,700 international dentists wanting to come to work in the UK. The process to make that happen is hugely bureaucratic and cumbersome, and I think that's part of the conversation that the Minister will be having with her counterparts, to how do we speed that up and streamline it, and how do we get them to come to Scotland and give them an educational, developmentally supportive way into the NHS in Scotland, and in return for that there would be an element of tie-in, I would imagine, to providing service to the population.
So I asked a question, I'll come back to the 5,700 because that's really interesting and helpful to know, but I asked the question because of the evidence that we've heard in terms of the number of dentists and practices that have went private, and solely private, if notwithstanding what the outcome may or may not be regarding the discussions, I fear that even if the discussions come to a successful outcome for both sides, I fear that the majority of these dentists will not go back into the NHS, will probably just remain private, so there will still then be a shortfall in the future in terms of NHS dentistry provision across parts of the country. So in terms of the increasing the number of dentists to come in to the scheme and to come in to actually provide those services, I think will be hugely important.
No. And I think that's part of that kind of international dentist work about we need to make Scotland the attractive place to come and work. Because if I'm honest, there is an element of some people say that the international dentists come across, they go into practices. Not many come to Scotland currently. They go into practice and there's a bit of exploitation there. They're just seen as a bit of a workhorse. And I think if they come to Scotland, they need to know our system. They need to understand our system. They need to feel supported by our system. And I think that's what we need to do in discussion with NHS education. We did it 20 years ago when we brought a cohort of 50 Polish dentists across. Probably about half of them are still working in Scotland. And that was a great programme. So we learned a lot from that. And I think we probably need to do that again. Mm.
I must admit, I know that my dental practice is something from the EU is still there,
yeah.
Came in, which is greatly appreciated. In terms of the 5,700,
sure.
What other aspects would you consider or have considered to try and entice people to actually come to Scotland?
So those 5,700 have applied to come and register as a dental therapist. So it means they can do the bulk of what a dentist does, but not all of it. And because that's the easiest way into registration and getting into the UK. So that would be great if we could do that. We then work with that cohort of dentists to make sure they go through that. There's an exam they have to sit to allow them to then register as a dentist. But actually within Scotland, we could almost provide an educational programme to get them to that end point. And because I think that's really important that if a young dentist has made the effort to cross continents to come and work in Scotland, that we need to support them so that they can actually be the best dentist that they can be. And I think we would want to do that. Another thing is, and I think that's part of the conversation for ministers to have at UK level, is if we actually had a notion of provisional registration. So, yes, you're a dentist from overseas. You are provisionally registered to work in the UK. You work in Scotland, you build a portfolio, and if you satisfactorily provide evidence that you're working safely, that you just automatically become registered as a dentist. That would be so much better than going through all the other hoops. And the other thing that we've been looking at is, it's called an international BDS, and it's happening in a university in England, where you take an international dentist and they just do the final 2 years, 18 months of a British BDS course, and then they sit our final exam. And with that, it brings an automatic registration to work in the UK. And I think that's another really supportive and streamlined way of getting that international workforce into work in Scotland. So they're all up for discussion. I speak to the three other CDOs. We debate how the best way to approach this, and hopefully the minister's taking the lead and actually saying we need to get together at a ministerial level will help drive that forward.
So these do generally do sound like useful tools in the armoury to actually help deal with the situation that we face. But going back to one of the points that the Minister raised earlier on, quite rightly, it's the financial situation is tough. So how would these be paid for?
Well, I would be making a bid into government for funding to make it happen. Because if we need to grow the workforce, we have to find the resource to do it. It's not going to happen in any other way.
The weird and wonderful ways of government finance.
Okay. Just on another question, just regarding the issue of the directors of dentistry, I did ask a question last week. And John had touched upon the issue of Shetland earlier. What exactly is their role and what are they contributing? Potentially, are they costing a lot of money for very little by way of return?
I could do a brief summary and then you can do the detail. I don't believe they are a waste of money. I think they are key to ensuring that the NHS boards understand the level of service that they have within their board areas, and also have the connection with the work that actually happens within the hospital settings. So I think, as David talked about, the Scottish Government is providing a framework to ensure that we have the right support for dentistry within the health boards. It raises up the profile of dentistry within the health boards as well, and I think that's incredibly important. I've also met with the BDA to talk about the operations that have to happen in a healthcare setting, so in a hospital, and it's understanding the impact of the pandemic has had on them and on waiting lists. And again, by having that conversation, that has brought that, raised it, I suppose, in the priorities for us to look at as a government. So no, I don't think they're a waste of money. I think they're an incredibly important resource across Scotland.
I would add that they were phenomenally helpful during the pandemic. They just came into being probably just before the pandemic, and they were probably barely used to the role before we were thrown into what's happening in the pandemic. It gives us a one-point contact at a health board, which previously we didn't have. If CDO needed to know something at a health board, he or she had to work out who was the person they had to go to. So now there is that single point of contact, and they know the system really well. So it improves communication backwards and forwards. In terms of Mr. Mason, I think you're a bit unfair about Shetland, because yes, there is one practice, but there's a public dental service and there are hospital dental services, and they have to do everything. So that director of dentistry in an island board probably has far more functions than perhaps someone in Greater Glasgow and Clyde who has a bit of a team to support them. So, you know, they are just as valuable in an island and a rural health board as an urban health board.
Consider yourself suitably reprimanded, John.
I've got one final question, if I may. It's very brief.
Very quickly, yep.
Just on the issue of tie-ins, whether it's graduates or potentially folk from the 5,700, what length of time would you consider would be the preferred option in terms of a tie-in for new dentists?
I think I've thought that far ahead, but we currently have a bursary. We have a bursary that's available to undergraduates, and I think they are tied in for the number of years they receive the bursary plus one. So that's the way we currently... Is that correct? Yeah, that's the way we currently work it. So the number of years of financial support you get plus one is what we currently use, and it may be something like that.
Could that be increased, the tie-in?
Well, I suppose we could set it at any level. It's just whether or not it then becomes less attractive if the tie-in is greater. What you want is them to come and work in Scotland, enjoy it, and want to stay.
OK, Stuart, I'm going to move on.
Thank you.
Minister, if you're OK, we're over time at the minute, but a couple of supplementaries, if you're happy to hold on for a couple of minutes.
I'm sure that's fine.
Yep. Brian.
Thank you. I'll just go back to something you said earlier, Mr. Ferris, around encouraging people to come in from overseas to come working. You said there was like 50, we brought in 50 Polish dentists, is that correct? I have an issue with that. I have a moral issue with that, in that we're sucking talent from everywhere else, and while we're doing that, we're also allowing our own talent to leave and our own talent to work privately, not in NHS dentistry. You see what I'm getting at here? Should we not be focusing more on how we retain our own talent within NHS dentistry?
So we're doing both. The reform space that we're currently in, the point of that is to make it an attractive, financially viable place for people to want to work. Now, as someone said, they might not. The people who have left the NHS may not come back. Some might. But hopefully it'll stop further drift. That's what we want to see. We want to make it a decent NHS system that people will want to work in. But we also do have a workforce issue. You know, the number of dentists who used to come in from the EU made a significant contribution to our workforce, and we miss that because it's disappeared. So if there are other dentists from overseas who want to come and work, and I understand your point, are we taking them away from the system, their own healthcare system? But I've spoken to several people who have experience of education and training and healthcare overseas, and they say it's really not a problem, especially in Asian countries. So India, Pakistan, the Middle East, they train a significant number of dentists. They train too many dentists. So we are not denuding those countries of healthcare workforce. No, but we need to find a way to get them in. So if we can get the conversation with the other three UK jurisdictions about how we get international dentists in a streamlined pathway, then that's all to the good. They want to come and work here. There will be a benefit to them because we will provide education and training for them, and they will support our population by delivering care.
And also support our population as well, which we need to increase.
One final question. I presume all four nations of the UK are having similar issues in terms of getting recruitment for dentistry. Tom, you said there's 5,700 people potentially wanting to come here to practice dentistry at varying levels. What's the hold-up? We've got an urgent problem, so why is there a difficulty?
So the hold-up is probably the anachronistic legislative framework that the General Dental Council work within, and that's within the gift of DH, and I think that's why we need to impress on the Minister for down there with responsibility for dentistry that needs to be fixed. You know, England has just as many pressures in terms of dental workforce as we do. They may have some more acute workforce areas, and especially their coastal areas. They have real difficulty in filling posts. So it's in their interest too that we find a streamlined, quick way of getting this willing workforce to come and work safely for us.
OK. Thank you very much. I know we've gone over time, so I do appreciate your generosity in that. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Minister. The committee will consider the evidence heard later in this meeting. I'd like to thank the Minister and our colleagues for their attendance this morning, and I will now suspend the meeting. Thank you very much. I now bring this meeting back into session. Agenda item number 3 is consideration of the draft annual reports for the parliamentary years from the 13th of May 2022 to the 12th of May 2023 and from the 13th of May 2023 to 12th of May 2024. The purpose of the reports is to set out our activities in the relevant reporting periods. Members will see that we are considering an annual report for the previous parliamentary year as well as for the current one. The reason for this is, as members will be aware, that the Scottish Parliament agreed motion number S6M09720 last night to wind up this committee. As a consequence, this will be our final meeting before the committee is formally dissolved on the 14th of July 2023. I will leave in general remarks about the reporting year until the end of the agenda item. First of all, I propose to go through the reports page by page for any corrections. If you have any comments on any paragraphs, please just raise your hand and when I come to the relevant section. Now, typos have been picked up and will all be addressed at a later date. Now, we're going to go through the report page by page. So, we are on... Okay. We are starting with COVID-19 Recovery Committee Annual Report 2022-23. And we will look at... Page 1. Okay. Page 1. Any changes? Nope. Page 2. All agreed. Page 3. Nope. Page 4. Page 5. Yes, John.
It was just in paragraph 9 where it says tackling misinformation. I just wondered if we could add and disinformation because I think we looked at both, one being perhaps unintentional and one being intentional.
Okay. All agreed?
Yeah.
Agreed. Page 5. Page 6. Page 7. Page 8. Page 9. Page 10. Page 11. Page 12. Page 13. Okay, we're now on to the next annual report, the COVID-19 Recovery Committee, COVID Recovery Committee Annual Report 2023-24. And we'll go through the same process. Page 1. Okay. Page 2. Page 3. Page 4. Page 5, page 6, everybody agreed?
Yep.
Thank you. I can confirm the annual reports are all agreed. The clerks will make minor revisions to the statistics and any other relevant factual information prior to publication in due course. And I'd like to really take this opportunity to thank all the stakeholders who have participated in the work of our session. Particularly, I have to say, from my point of view, the long COVID people who came in under great duress, they were clearly, some of them were struggling, and I just want to point them out. It's greatly benefited our consideration of the issues we have scrutinised relating to COVID and recovery. I'd also like to thank the current and former members of the committee for the collegiate way in which you have worked through our scrutiny. In the height of the pandemic, I think it was a great benefit to the Parliament to have a dedicated committee to scrutinise the relevant legislation and our transition into a recovery period. Going forward, it will be for the other subject committees to take forward scrutiny of COVID recovery as it relates to their remits, and we will make recommendations on this when we come to consider our legacy report. Does any other member wish to make any other remarks before we conclude this agenda item? Murdo.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, can I just echo your thanks to everybody who's contributed to the committee, to our clerking team, to Spice and to all those who've helped us. And thank you, Convener, for a very short stint as Convener, but you can put that on your CV for future reference. You convened a parliamentary committee, albeit just for a few weeks, and for leading the committee in collegiate style. And I should also thank our committee advisers, who we've not seen actually for quite a long time, but initially were regular attenders at the committee. That was Professor Peter Donnelly, Professor Susie Dunnicky, and Professor Helen Stagg. And I think we will recall when they were coming more or less on a weekly basis to give us updates at the height of the COVID pandemic, and their input was extremely useful to us. So I think we should record our thanks to them. I don't know if we're going to formally write to them to express our thanks to them, but I think we should do that. And I would just reflect personally, I was the first convener of the what was then the Coronavirus Committee in the last Parliament. If I remember rightly, we were set up, I think it was May 2020, the committee was established, and here we are just over 3 years later, bringing this particular journey to an end.
Indeed.
Which I hope is an indication that COVID is behind us. I hope that's not a hostage to fortune in saying that, but I hope it's an indication that COVID is behind us. Nevertheless, you know, there are very important lessons we need to learn from COVID. There's a lot still need to be done in terms of the public sector, public services that need to be put right post-COVID. And I hope the important work this committee has been doing will be continued by other subject committees as we go into the next parliamentary session.
Indeed. Well done. Thank you, Murdo. Has anybody else any other comments? No. I'd personally like to thank the clerking team. They have been absolutely brilliant. They've made me look almost competent. I'd also like to mention Alec Rowley. He's been a fantastic member of the team. And, of course, the previous convener, Siobhan Brown, who was given a ministerial post earlier on, which is why I now sit in this chair. Thank you. That concludes this public part of our meeting, and I suspend the meeting to move into private. Thank you.